I am in Vadodara, Gujarat, and time right now is around 6:15 p.m. and I want to show you the sunset.
In fact, if I take you to a place called Guhar Moti in Gujarat, which is the westernmost point of India, here the sun sets at around 6:30 p.m. Now let me take you to the easternmost point of India, to a place called Kebithu in Arunachal Pradesh. It's a small beautiful village located at the border of India and China. By the time sun sets here, the clock reads 4:30 p.m. Barely late afternoon. This is because we have just one time zone, called the Indian Standard Time or IST. China also has one time zone. They follow Beijing time, and because of that, a weird thing happens where there is a city in China called Kashgar, where in summers, sun can set after 10 p.m. in the night. On the opposite end, we have USA, where we follow 6 time zones.
So on one hand, USA is having so many multiple time zones, but on the other hand, India is having just one time zone. So will India benefit from having like 2 or more time zones? Or will it just cause utter chaos and confusion all around? For answering this question, I have to take you back. I have to take you back in time. I have to take you back roughly 175 years in time.
12th August 1853. It was a beautiful early morning. A train carrying 475 passengers was speeding through the tracks. Already running behind schedule, the train was travelling at 60 km per hour, the maximum speed of trains in the 1850s. As the train was about to enter this blind curve, the train driver checked his watch. The watch showed 7:55 am, and as per schedule, the driver had exactly 5 minutes to cross this blind stretch of rail track. Now you see, this was important, as there was another train waiting on the other side. And in the next 5 minutes, if this train doesn't see any incoming train, it'll slide onto the main track and start to push forward.
Now, even though it was close in terms of times, it was still doable.
Otherwise, the first train would need to wait for the second train to pass through, which would push it further behind the schedule. Not wanting to get late, driver of the first train was running his train at full speed, not knowing that his watch is actually running 2 minutes late. This meant, now instead of 5 minutes, he has only 3 minutes to cross this blind curve, something that was impossible as trains in 1850s had the maximum speed of only 60 kilometers per hour. After a few minutes, this train came on to the main track and started cruising towards the blind curve, not knowing this was about to become its last train ride. At around 8 a.m., both of these trains ...14 souls perished. 17 suffered serious injuries, with countless others suffering less serious injuries.
Even though this train accident happened in US, it was one of the many accidents that happened across US, across UK, and even in India. And if you remember, British ruled India during that time. And we'll come to India in a bit. See, the problem was every railway station across US used to maintain its own local time. Now, this meant lots of confusion over scheduling of trains, lots of problem in calibrating of watches of train conductors who used to run these trains, which would lead to near misses of trains at best and train crashes at worst. So let me stand here on the ground. You guys have to carefully watch the shadow it makes. Now, this was the way to measure time before time zones even existed.
As the earth spins on its axis, this shadow keeps moving, both in terms of angle as well as length. But this special moment, when the shadow is of the shortest length, at this time, the sun is directly overhead. This time is called solar noon. In other words, this time is called 12 o'clock, and now every other second, minute, hour is tracked with respect to this time that we define as 12 o'clock.
In other words, when sun is directly over my head, my shadow that is formed is of the shortest length, and it is 12 o'clock at a place where I'm currently standing, which is Vadodara, Gujarat.
I want to point out here that this is the local time of Vadodara, that is 12 o'clock is the local time of Vadodara, Gujarat, and not the actual India time, which is around 12:22 p.m. at the time of solar noon in Vadodara. And in some time, we'll understand exactly why this is the case.
You see, the obvious problem with this method is every city will now have a different solar time, which means every city will have a different local time. Now, if your time is different than my time, then this time is useless.
This was the exact concept behind Jantar Mantar. Jantar Mantar of Jaipur has the world's largest stone dial which tells Jaipur's local time. It was built by Rajput King Sawai Jai Singh in 1734, and the time it tracked was used as his kingdom's time. The word Jantar means instrument and Mantar means calculating. In other words, calculating machine. I am fascinated by how humans view time. If you think about it, time is just a combination of random numbers stitched together to represent a particular instant. For example, I have a meeting at 10 a.m. on 31st of December. These random numbers represent this particular moment in the future. Without the concept of time, it's impossible to represent any moment from both past or future. Without time, the only thing that you can represent is the present.
Time is the most useful concept that humans have ever created. But it is only useful as long as all of us humans can agree on a common way to represent these random numbers into what we call as time. But if every section of the society uses their own version of time, then for these sections of the society, it would be impossible for them to communicate with each other.
This is why in 1884, delegates of 26 countries participated in the International Meridian Conference held in Washington, D.C. They basically divided Earth into 24 equal parts, with each part covering 15 degrees of longitude. Now, since Earth rotates 360 degrees in 24 hours, each hour corresponds to 15 degree rotation. This means if it is 12 o'clock here, implying that the sun is directly overhead, here the local time would be 1 p.m. And here the local time will be 11 a.m. Of all these longitudes or meridians as they are technically called, they chose the one passing through Greenwich as the initial one. Or in other words, this meridian got selected as the prime meridian. Greenwich was in UK. UK at the time controlled the most colonies in the world. They controlled 80% of the ship's industry in the world. Hence, UK basically got to choose. After this conference, every time zone got calibrated to GMT or Greenwich Mean Time. For example, US Eastern Time is GMT minus 5 hours, whereas Australia Standard Time is GMT plus 8 hours.
Conversions between time zones got super easy, and this was instrumental to the international trade, which was growing at a crazy speed at that time.
During this time, India was under British Raj, and India had 4 time zones at the time. Bombay time, which was GMT plus 4 hours 51 minutes, Calcutta time, which was GMT plus 5 hours 53 minutes 20 seconds, Madras time, which was GMT plus 5 hours 21 minutes 14 seconds, and Port Blair time, which was GMT plus 6 hours 10 minutes and 37 seconds. Now, as railways was growing in India, this system of time zones was a nightmare to maintain. Imagine you are traveling from Bombay to Madras by train. How much mental maths you would do to add 30 minutes, 14 seconds every time to convert Bombay time to Madras time?
After the International Meridian Conference that happened in Washington, D.C., British introduced Indian Standard Time or IST to India in 1906.
This line passed at 82 degrees 32 minutes longitude, which is roughly half of India. It is near the Mirzapur area. This was the GMT plus 5 hours 30 minutes. Obviously, this was much more calculation friendly than the 4 time zones that existed at the time. Now, as the independent movement was taking a strong hold in India, Bombay and Calcutta refused to adopt this British imposed Indian Standard Time. They continued to use the Bombay Standard Time and Calcutta Standard Time as a symbol of protest against the British.
After India gained independence, the government officially adopted this line as Indian Standard Time or IST.
But there was a problem with this. You see, India is a big country. It spans around 2,933 kilometers, which is roughly 30 degrees of longitude. This means when the sun is directly above this point, signifying 12 noon local time, at this point, the sun is still rising and the local time is actually 10 a.m. The time difference is of 2 hours, which is huge. So instead of keeping two time zones here and here, India decided to have just one time zone in the middle at GMT plus 5:30. Reasoning was, at the time, India wasn't ready to deal with the complexities of having two time zones.
Here's the thing, you can argue for it or you can argue against it, but it did lead to very serious consequences.
People living here get a lot of daylight during their working hours, which means lower electricity costs versus people living here. Then there is a human capital cost. Even though daylight hours are different in these parts of India, school still starts at 7:30 a.m. in almost all parts of India. Normal work hours are 9:30 a.m. to 6:30 p.m. in almost all parts of India. You see, when the sun goes down, your body starts producing a hormone called melatonin, also known as the sleep hormone. It's basically your body's way of saying, hey, it's time to sleep.
Now, if the sun sets later in one region compared to the other region, the melatonin production in the body starts later too. But here's the thing about school. School starts at a fixed time all across India. Let's say at 7:30 a.m.
That means children living where the sun sets later end up sleeping less. And less sleep doesn't just make them tired, it affects their learning. Studies show that every 1 hour delay in sunset reduces a child's sleep by 30 minutes, which over time can lower their total years of education by almost 0.8 years.
In other words, they are less likely to complete their primary education.
Similar things are observed in adults. This paper puts the overall human capital cost at $4.2 billion. That is, this is the amount that we will gain if we move to a two time zone system versus the one time zone system that we have today. In fact, the tea gardens of Assam have long set their clock 1 hour ahead of IST, creating their own informal time zone called the Chai Bagan time. In fact, National Physical Laboratory, which is an institution responsible for maintaining time in India, have themselves suggested moving to two time zone system. But
government has cited execution challenges, administrative overhead, and higher complexities, and currently is not in favor of a two time zone system. And believe me, the challenges are very real. Imagine private offices, public offices, government offices, local businesses, they all have to coordinate across India over a two time zone system. Government has also said that it might lead to scheduling errors in train timetables and thus may lead to increase of risk of train accidents. Having one time zone is just easy, it is just convenient. And it may also promote a sense of unity in a country where we have so many reasons to be divided on.
At least this is the argument used by China, which spans four time zones, which means the time difference between these two points is approximately 4 hours. But still, they all use Beijing time as mandated by Chinese Communist Party as it promotes unity. At the same time, we have countries like US which span a big area and they use a 6 time zone system for most optimal alignment of daylight with working hours, increasing their productivity, increasing their capital output.
I hope you got to learn something valuable today. If you did, do subscribe to this channel. Let's meet in the next video. Thank you.